So let's go and take a few steps and see that how this all works out, and see that what kind of value of y do we get. So eventually what our motto is or aim is to find out the value of y at x equal to 9 and to see that how far it is from the original boundary condition which is given at x equal to 9, which is y sub 0 y sub 9 equal to 0. So if I'm going to choose I equal to 0, I'm going to get y1 is equal to y naught plus the value of the function f1 at x naught comma y naught comma z naught times h. And z1 equal to z naught plus value of the function f2 at x naught comma y naught comma z naught times h. Now let's go and see that what these values are. We know that x naught is 0. That's what we are starting from. We know that y naught is 0 because that's the value of y at x equal to 0. And then z naught, which is the value of the derivative of y at x equal to 0, which is the assumed value, which is 4. And we also know that h is equal to 3 because that's the step size which we are choosing. And we also know what f1 and f2 are because that's what we derived just now. So we get y1 is equal to y naught, which is 0, plus the value of the function f sub 1 at 0, comma 0, z naught is 4, times 3. And what is f1? f1 is nothing but z. So z, what's the value of z? It's 4, 4 times 3, so I get 12. So that's the value of y sub 1. Let's go and see that what the value of z sub 1 is. Z sub 1 will be equal to z naught, which is 4, plus f sub 2 calculated at the same value 0, 0, 4, 0, comma 0, comma 4, times 3. That's 4 plus, so what is the value of the function f sub 2 at 0, comma 0, comma 4? Is 2 times y, which is the value 0, plus 8 times x, which is 0, times 9 minus x, which is 9 minus 0, times 3. And that just gives me 4 plus 0 times 3, because 2 times 0 is 0, 8 times 0 is 0. So I get just 0 from here, and I get here 4. So that's the value of y1 and z1 at I equal to 1, which means that x equal to. So these are the values. So y1, which is y1, is the approximate, y at x1 is the approximate value at y1. Is approximately equal to y1, which is 12, and z at x1 is the approximate value of z1, is approximately equal to z1, which is equal to 4. Where x1 is what? x1 is nothing but 3. x1 is nothing but 3. Okay. So, but that isn't, we're not going to stop here. The reason why we're not going to stop here is because we have to find y sub 3, because that's what the value of y at x equal to 9 is. So if we follow the same procedure, this is what we're going to get. We're going to say I is equal to 1 now. We're going to get y sub 2 is equal to y sub 1 plus f sub 1, x sub 1, comma y sub 1, comma z sub 1 times h. And z sub 2 will be equal to z sub 1 plus f sub 2, x1, y sub 1, z sub 1 times h. Let's go and see that what arguments and what values need to go in here. We just said x1 is 3 because it is equal to x naught plus h, which is 0 plus 3, and that's what we get as 3. That's where this 3 comes from. And then we know that y sub 1 we calculated from the previous step, not iteration, previous step, which is y sub 1 equal to 12, and z sub 1 is equal to 4. So from there, we'll get y sub 2 is equal to y1, which is 12, plus the value of the function being calculated, x sub 1, which is 3, y sub 1, which is 12, z sub 1, which is 4, times 4. And since we know that f1 is nothing but z, that's just 4, 4 times 4, so that gives us 16 times 12 is 28. 16 plus 12 is 28. Sorry, 4 times, this is, h is 3, So it is 4 times 3, and that makes it 24. So similarly, what is the value of Z2? The value of Z2 is Z1, which is 4, plus the value of the function F(2). The arguments are the same, 3, 12, and 4, times 3. So in this case, what is F(2)? F(2) is nothing but 2 times Y, so it will be 2 times 12, plus 8 times X, which is 3, times 9 minus X, which is 9 minus X, which is 3, times 3. And this value here will turn out to be 4 plus 168 times 3, and we get 508. So what we have now is that the value of Y at X2 is 24. The value of Z at X2 is 508, which we just found out here. And that's at X2 equal to 6, okay, because we are at this step of X2. So what we need to figure out now is that, hey, we need to find Y at 9, but these are the values at 6. These are approximately equal to. So we need to find out what the value of 6 is. So we need to conduct one more step. So let's see if we're going to conduct one more step, what we get. So again, we're going to choose I equal to 2. We're going to get Y(3) is equal to Y(2), plus the value of the function X1, which is X2, comma Y(2), comma Z(2) times H. Z(3) is equal to Z(2) plus F(2) times X2, Y2, comma Z2 times H. Let's go and figure out what each of these parameters which we have in here, what we need to substitute in there. X2 is nothing but X1 plus H. X3 is X2 plus H. X2 we just found out is 6. We need to put X2 in there, right? We need to put X2 in there. So X2 will be equal to X1 plus H. X1 is 3. 3 plus 3 is 6. We also know that Y(2) is 24 from the previous step. We also know that Z(2) is 508 from the previous step. So based on this, we are now going to find what value of Y(3) and Z(3) are. So Y(3) will be equal to Y(2), which is 24, plus the value of the function at these arguments of X(2), which is 6. Y(2) is 24, Z(2) is 508, times H, which is 3. So we get 24. We know F(1) is nothing but Z, which is 508 times 3. And this value here turns out to be 1548. And now we want to calculate, we don't need to calculate Z(3), because all we are is after Y(3). So what Y(3) is the value of Y at X3, which is approximately Y(3), which is 1548, which we just found out. So what you're finding out is that by assuming Y prime of 0 equal to 4, what you have obtained is Y(3) equal to 1548. That's what you're getting. Or I should say, let's just write it down here. By assuming Y prime of 0 equal to 4, what you have found out is that Y(9) is approximately equal to 1548. But what is Y(9) actually? Y(9) is actually 0. So what we need to do is we need to assume Y prime of 0 to be something else so that we get a different value for Y(9) equal to something, which hopefully will be close to 0. And that's something which we'll do in the next segment.